In the early 1970s, Mario Puzo and Francis Ford Coppola created two of the most influential films in American motion picture history, recipients of 9 Academy Awards, including 2 for Best Picture. Nearly 20 years later, Puzo, Coppola, and many of their original collaborators assembled to make The Godfather Part 3. Here are their memories, spanning from 1970 to the present.
Then Paramount said, you're not going to use a real horse's head. I said, well, how can you do it? Make one out of plaster. So as the date approached, they sent a horse's head from Hollywood. That was all dusty and old.
Mr. Ed.
Mr. Ed is in there.
The horse is a horse.
It ought to be shot on one side and so on.
The pet lovers, when they protested that, is we ordered it from the same source where to get the pet food.
We wanted a horse that matched the real horse.
Right.
And then we had to put a certain diamond pattern on the head.
You know, I just remember about that thing is that we did that. We kept this head on ice for a while, obviously, I remember the day we shot the scene, it was extremely hot out, and John Marley stayed in bed with his horse's head in this heat. It was a little tacky, actually, for...
As we saw anything about the horse's head, is that when I read the book, I read it wrong. I thought that the horse was in the bed with him, and he looked at the sheets, and... Right. But now, as I read it, that's the way it is in the movie.
Yeah, right.
In reality, in the book, the horse was there. The horse's head was there right in front when he got up. He looked at it, and that little misreading led...
Wasn't in the bed?
It led me to suggest. I said, Bertie, what if he discovers it?
He wakes up, he feels
full of blood.
And finally, and then there it is.
But that wasn't the way the book was, but I misread it that way.
As the movies were made, The Godfather became just kind of the biggest home movie in history.
It's a man that doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man.
You gotta get a post like this, but a bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit.
Never take sides with anyone against the family again.
We're both part of the same hypocrisy. But never think it applies to my family.
Movies were very new to me, and Duval would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take.
It's because I admire you and I love you that I kept things secret from you.
Do you expect me to let you go? Do you expect me to let you take my children from me?
Godfather was textured or perfumed in a way by our memories of our Italian-American family.
Yeah, it starts to come.
cut to him.
Oh, we got cut. We got. I like that worked good when you played. That you hadn't been let up for like 20 years. You've had this responsibility, and the old.
The thing that's different about Godfather 3 and Godfather 2 is that Michael is different. But in order to see how he's different, we got to get a few tastes of it. Because we need a little emotion. If we could put a little emotion, like in three places in the movie, that would be the thing.
Just have the weight of the gravity. That's what does it. You know what I'm saying is that you've never, from the time you committed that first sin, you've never had the weight off of you. Okay? Well, and you must have. You can't take it anymore. Okay. Just to be different.
It seems to me that whatever the film lay in a balance, and if I kicked it one side and kicked it to be more personal and more even soap opera or more emotional, that would be enough to kick it over, you know?
The audience has got to be like this during this thing. You know, I mean, it's got to be, Jesus, this guy is cracking. This guy is, for the first time, I know he's really worried that he did the wrong thing. I mean, he's got a conscience. I mean, how can we put the intensity of that in this moment alone? You see, there's no one in the room except this corpse. So he can speak freely. And I mean, you almost could see him by the coffin being very emotional. And then he says, where did I go wrong, is what he's saying. But, or did it, is it too late for me? Are my sins too great? Did I love too much or too little?
There's a point, like, you know, you get a virtuous man and he commits an unvirtuous act. He's so horrified that he's committed that unvirtuous act that it becomes even more terrible. In the sense,
the only trouble is these are all intellectual ideas, and we're trying to get something really just emotional, that the guy's speaking from his heart. I mean, he's a guy who's clearly getting ready for death, and he's very worried that it's like King Lear, he hasn't set things right.
My history with The Godfather was very much the history of someone in trouble. I found the first movie very tough to do and very tough to finally pull off. I was a young director. I hadn't really done a lot of work, and I had this opportunity to do this novel. I thought of myself as a professional director making an adaptation of a novel. I knew that as the book became more popular and more successful, I realized that in a sense it was beginning to outclass me, and that I wouldn't have gotten the job had, you know, 5 months later the book become the sensation that it was. And even in the early weeks of the production, I knew that they were not happy with what I had done. The kind of classic style that I chose in rushes maybe didn't impress them. But I just wanted to survive it. I knew that my ideas regarding the casting were not popular. It had been a very difficult time to try to convince the studio that my notions about casting were right.
I remember he having a lot of he was having a lot of problems. Every time he mentioned Brando's name, one of the executives is the right word, said, if you mention his name again, you're out.
And the guy who was then the president said, as president of Paramount Pictures, these are his exact words, as president of Paramount Pictures, Marlon Brando will never appear in this motion picture.
Let me lay it on the line for you and your boss, whoever he is. Johnny Fontaine will never get that movie.
I remember I just sort of fell on the floor and said to them, you know, at least give me a chance. They're all right. If, number one, he does the movie for nothing, if he does a screen test, and if he puts up a bond guaranteeing that he, none of his shenanigans will cause a delay, you can consider him. So I said, all right. And I called up Brandon, whom I didn't know, and, you know, had made that contact, and said, oh, what if I do some makeup tests, I said, you know, to get around the screen test. And I went and I brought Italian cheese and cigars and stuff. And we were just shooting and shooting, and he saw the cheese and went like that, and he started to, like, take his hair and put shoe polish on. And he says, it's like a bulldog, because he puts some polish on. He goes, I want to have, you know. And he's doing this right there, and I'm shooting it, and then, like, he started going, He put Kleenex in his mouth, and he had black. It's remarkable to see.
Buonasera. Buonasera. What have I ever done to make you treat me so disrespectfully? If he'd come to me in friendship, then the scum that ruined your daughter would be suffering this very day. And if by chance an honest man like yourself should make enemies, then he would become my enemies. And then they would fear you.
Be my friend? Godfather?
In, I forget the amount of time, but a very short time, he knew the cast. As a matter of fact, Bobby Duvall, Al Pacino, and myself flew up to San Francisco, the Zoetrope. Eleanor, his wife, cut our hair, put a bowl over her head, cut our hair, and with a 16-millimeter camera, you know, we improvised and did some stuff. And that was it, okay?
Don, Don Corleone, please.
Hey, it's good, huh? It's good.
That cost like, it cost them like four corned beef sandwiches, I think, the whole, you know.
I was more or less just sort of wandering. I didn't know what was going on. I mean, movies were very new to me, and Duvall would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take. And I didn't want to laugh.
I hear this, Sonny, but if your father dies, make the deal. It's easy for you to say he's not your father. Wait a minute, it's easy for you to say it's not your father. It's easy for you to say it ain't your father. Fuck you and your asshole.
Very nice, Jim.
Thank you. Awesome. Come on, you asshole.
You started it.
I know you don't want to hear it, Sonny, but if your father dies, make the deal.
Well, it's easy for you to say he's not your father.
I think Jimmy at the time wanted to play Michael. Said, no, you should play Sonny. Well, I went, you know, and then I said, well, you read Hagen. I kept saying it was Hogan. Coppola said, no, it's Hagen. And, you know, it was all like a joke in a way, because who knew if it was going to be? But it was like, you know, I had seen Al on Broadway. I said, this kid would be terrific for this. And, you know, I mean, we talked about it, you know, informally.
You see, I'm not saying there's Sonny, you know, and saying, Sonny, you know, or Freddie, come here. I'd like you to meet...
He's
I'm not
sure
doing that. I'm
how far to go. So he does it in this very indirect way. He doesn't say, look, my father is a criminal, a gangster who has been shot. And he kind of tells her little anecdotes. And at first, right. It's nice. Even when it's lighter, it's fine. But the scene is a serious scene. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When I read The Godfather, whenever I would see the character of Michael...
Two.
I saw Al's face.
Luca Brasi held a revolver against Hallie's head and... My father told Hallie that either his signature or his brains would be on the contract.
He wasn't a star, which was not pleasing to the executives at that time. He didn't look like stars look like at that time in the business.
So that when they were suggesting, you know, like Ryan O'Neill or Robert Redford could be like a Northern Italian, I already had Al's... face ingrained.
Michael, why are all these people bothering your father on a day like this?
Oh, that's because they know that no Sicilian can refuse any request.
For some reason, they were not happy with Al's test. But I knew Francis wanted Al.
And 104. Action.
I was aware that they didn't want me. And at one point, it was actually, you know, it seemed okay, finally. I thought, Francis, look, I mean, we'll do another movie together. I was relatively young, so I didn't know quite. I thought, well, maybe they were all like this. You know, they get all... I had seen movies about Hollywood. I thought maybe that's why all the screen tests...
Well, this is a slow wedding. This isn't a wedding.
One night, I got a call from Francis. He was in New York, and he said... Jimmy, and I could tell from his voice, this was not his idea. Jimmy, why don't you come in and test? I said, test what? What, do you got a Porsche? You want me to drive around the block? What do you want? Test what? He said, please, they want you to play Michael. Why? Please, so I went in.
On 68.
Michael? Why are all those people bothering your father on a day like this?
Well, that's because they know no Sicilian can refuse a request on his daughter's wedding day.
Oh, good.
I don't think you can name an actor that wasn't there.
They were all sitting around on cement floors from 7 in the morning to late at night. Guys with, you know, some guys talk like this, you know. I mean, that guy's from all over the world.
They tried to kill him, my father. They did. They nearly did. Mr. Brazzi went after them. And so the story goes.
The story goes that he killed 6 men in 2 weeks. He killed 6 men in 2 weeks. 6 men in 1 week.
And he kept sneaking Al in, you know. At the end of the day, he kept testing Al, you know.
It kept happening a lot. And it was countless. They went on and on. I remember saying at the time, you know, I just don't respond well to being around where I'm not wanted. Well, anyway, he just stayed with it. It was his tenacity, and that got me in there.
Luca Brazzi held a gun to his head, and my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract. It's a true story.
A little point of memorabilia, that was Marsha Lucas, who was the editor, George's wife, who cut those tests all together. And she told me that she said, cast Al Pacino because he undresses you with his eyes.
Marsha said that.
Yeah.
She was right.
And Diane said, I said to Diane, which one do you want? She said, Al.
I knew Diane before the test. We had a kind of immediate like for each other. And Francis, I think, recognized that and thought that that would be useful in the picture.
You're trying to scare me. You don't want me to marry you. That's very clever, but it's not going to work. Okay.
I saw her in a movie called Lovers and Other Strangers, and two things. I just thought she was I just liked her myself. I thought she was a cute woman, you know. I just was attracted to her. But also because she was so eccentric and kind of weird in a way, her delivery, that I thought this character of Kay could be like really straight, boring character, and that maybe Diane would bring some eccentricity to it.
Fredo, my brother Fredo, this is Kay Adams.
Hi.
How you doing?
So what I'm saying is that they spent $400,000 or so on tests and wound up with the 4 corned beef sandwiches.
I wish that you could get inside of Al's head a little more, Michael's character, because he's always such a master manipulator. See, Michael has intellectual side, so that it's like he does have an inkling about his tragedy. We could kind of like put the nail on that, really say it emotionally.
But just have the weight of the gravity, that's what does it.
It's hard to get into Michael Corleone's head. I mean, he was such a creature of the time that he lived in.
Okay.
The father did what he did to protect his children. Then the child grew up and did what he did to protect his children, but got himself into a moral quandary. So he's worried that he's somewhere between the past and the future. And he says, no, it's too late for me, you know, time has passed me by.
I was already hired as Michael. They kept saying, well, when is he going to do something? While we were shooting, there were hints coming back to me that I wasn't wanted. And with more than hints, people were actually, you know, giggling when I'd go on camera. And the studio kept seeing this footage coming back, and they said, well, he seems dull. I was out. And then the Sollozzo scene came.
Ti senti meglio?
Sì.
What guarantees can I give you, Mike? I am the hunted one. I missed my chance. You think too much of me, kid. I'm not that clever. All I want is a truce.
They kept me after that scene. That looked pretty good, I guess, when you could shoot a guy. Because they wanted me to assert myself, so there, what, you know, there's that kind of assertion.
You got to go with the moment and see what happens and try not to plan too much and see, you know. Like, I know, especially in that scene where I had to tell Brando that Sonny's dead, we'd done 1, 2, and 3 takes, and I usually like to do 1 or 2, and that's it. But Francis said, maybe, let's try another one, take 4. And the other were fine. I would have been satisfied, but take 4, boom, was the thing that worked for me. That, you know, that nobody can take it away from me now that it's in print, you know, on film.
My wife is crying upstairs. I hear cars coming to the house. Consigliere mine. I think you should tell your Don what everyone seems to know.
I didn't tell Mama anything. I was about to come up and wake you just now and tell you.
But she needed a drink first.
But this time, when I said Sonny died, something worked so right.
And now you've had your drink.
They shot Sonny on the causeway. He's dead.
And Brando is a scene over the body. It was a wonderful emotional scene he did. But before they rolled, he said, Francis, could I have a moment? You know, and he kind of gets himself ready, prepares himself emotionally, and then he does it. It was wonderful.
I don't want his mother to see him this way. And look how they massacred my boy.
About 2-3 days later, I had to walk across the room, and Jimmy said, with his shoulders, you know, like, Francis, could Bobby have a moment? So I go like this. Then I walk across him and say, cut, Brando, give me a dirty look.
I remember a thing that happened on The Godfather that when we were working on it, I got the message that Bob Evans felt that there wasn't enough violence in the picture and that they were going to literally send a violence director in to kind of come in and do the violence.
It's funny.
I went that night with my sister Tally and my little boy Gio to the set. And we, with Gio playing Carlo, who was like 8 years old, 9 years old, and Tally being there, I think I may have had a video camera, but I went in there and said, okay, violence.
You just told me to make you dinner.
Hey, Bafangul, huh?
Oh, Bafangul, you!
And we went down and we rehearsed it, and we thought how interesting it would be if she was pregnant and pitiful and hid behind the curtain and...
Knock down all the dishes. Then you go over there and knock down all the vases. Then Gio, go in there. Here's this little boy going in with the strap, hitting his aunt. Now run through. Now break the window. Now crash the thing, you know.
Now clean it up!
You look at that scene, you see the scene directed by a man who knew a violence director was coming.
Yeah. And Francis is very open, you know, to... there were a few scenes I remember. Once, at the beginning of the picture, I asked the prop master to cut an industrial broom handle off and put it in my car. He says, Jimmy, it's not in the script anyway. I said, so what? I mean, it's just put it there, you know. And sure enough, you know, when I got out of the car, it wasn't scripted, and Francis didn't expect it. And when I fired it at Gianni Russo.
Come here, come here.
Tried out for the part of Sonny. And he did, we shot a test on De Niro, which I think exists, that was so electrifying.
I think I did. Did I do the screen test for Sonny? Yeah. Me and 4,000 other people or whatever, we all came in.
You're gonna take both of them out on me. You're gonna take them. And you know what they're gonna do to you? And you know what you do when you knock somebody off? You take a gun, you shoot him right up against his fucking head. That's what you do. You get his brains all over your nice new Ivy League suit, Michael. That's what happens. How do you like that?
Spectacular, but it was Sonny really like killer, you know, like nothing you could ever sell.
I know you can do it. All right, you prove it to me. You can do it. Go ahead, prove it.
Hey, what are you going to do? Nice college boy, huh? Didn't want to get mixed up in the family business? Huh? Now you want to gun down a police captain? Why, because he slapped you in the face a little bit? Huh? What do you think, this is the army where you shoot him a mile away? You got to get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit. Come here.
But I never forgot that, you know, and later on when we were stumped on how to do the young Marlon, I thought that he could be the young Brando. I went to Paramount, I told them the idea, they said no.
No. One thing we were trying in Sicily when I was older, Brando had some thing in his mouth, and I went to the same dentist and just got a smaller one. And I tried to, like, get a little heavier for that period because he was a little older and a little, you know, a little mature and so on. And so one of the things we were trying to decide was about the mustache, whether I should have a mustache or not. And it was a whole thing back and forth to make this commitment to have the mustache or not to have the mustache. So finally, I said, you forget these things, but I think the way I remember it is, I said, well, why don't we flip a coin? And just flip the coin, and heads it's on, tails it's off, and so it was heads, I guess.
Mio padre si chiama Antonio Andolini e questo è Pazzi.
The second movie, we had a disastrous preview 2 weeks before, 3 weeks before it opened in San Francisco, and we made a lot of changes that week, and then showed it in San Diego, and it seemed to play much better. And I worked very hard on Godfather 2 to try to have you feel what these people were feeling, because the story was a double parallel, which kind of made it hard to follow one line. The main character was turning into a zombie.
Connie, why don't you tell him marriage is out of the question and you don't want to see him anymore? He'll understand, believe me. If you don't listen to me and marry this man, you'll disappoint me.
And I think the version that was shown in San Diego was more heavily intercut. That the stories, each story interrupted the other more often. Rather than 12 back and forth, there were 20 back and forth or something. And the direction that we went after that screening was to just clear the decks a little bit, and or a lot, actually, and let the story tell itself up to a point and then go back to the other story, and then let that story tell itself and go back. So that was an ongoing struggle, which, and I remember Francis saying at the end of that, if we'd only had 2 more weeks, it could have been great.
In Godfather 2, at the end of Godfather 2, as you remember, there's a scene where they flash back to the family in the happy days, and Sonny was still alive, and everyone's sitting around a dinner table.
Here's the cake.
And hey, in this scene, Brando was going to be there too. you know, as a small cameo. And up until the very last minute, they expected Brando to appear for that day of shooting.
Oh, honey, that's nice, huh?
Should I put the candles on now?
Yeah, go on. You help, all right, Carlos?
Sure.
Unfortunately, when the day finally arrived, Brando didn't show. There were legal problems, deal problems, etc. So Francis improvised and came up with the idea of making the event that everyone had gathered for Brando's surprise birthday party.
He's here. Come on.
Come on. Come on. Stupid.
One feels the presence of Brando without seeing him, which almost makes him more mythical and more of a memory than seeing the man's face would have done.
The second one was a continuation, and in a way it was a kind of a descent, in a way, into trying to hold on to everything and losing it.
Fredo, you're nothing to me now. You're not a brother. You're not a friend. I don't want to know you or what you do. I don't want to see you at the hotels. I don't want you near my house. When you see our mother, I want to know a day in advance so I won't be there. You understand?
Mikey.
Generally, making The Godfather, the first Godfather, was just like nonstop anxiety and, you know, wondering when I was going to get fired. And
we had two kids, and I was pregnant with a third. And it was like kind of a horrifying time because it seemed like at any moment the whole thing would collapse. And
I remember once being in the men's room and, you know, some crew members came in and they were talking, you know, like, you know, what a piece of junk, and that guy doesn't know what he's doing.
No one knew when you were going to be fired on that first movie. And so the thing is, just get enough footage in the can, you know. Keep going, keep shooting.
When I look back at the pleasure of it, it's I guess the pleasure looking back is the thing. That's the pleasure, that you're able to look back and that you survived.
During the first few weeks of Godfather 1, I gained a great deal of respect for him. For what he had to go through, what Paramount was putting him through with the second, not a second unit director, a second director following him around in case he was fired, you're out, this guy goes right in. And that's a fact.
When I hear people talk about how they've liked some of those films years later or that they were wonderful films, all I can think of is, you know, well, I wish I had heard it then because I could have sure used the encouragement.
And when I think of The Godfathers, I think of Michael in that hat walking along the gravel. That was a real turning point. Remember when Carlo is being garroted in the car and it does, and then afterward he walks, and he walks with the three guys? That's the image for me.
See, Michael was so wrapped in the fact that he was right, that what he was doing was right, that it blinded him and it blighted his heart. In other words, was I so sure that I was right that I, you know, I mean, that's why he says, did my heart betray me? This time, don't say give one more chance, just say give me the chance to redeem myself, if you can remember. See, anything that could show Michael really turning on himself. Can we go? I mean, the guy is really worried that he maybe is a bad man. Finally, he's torn between good and evil. I mean, he is literally torn apart. Maybe he's talking about one thing and then he...
I think when Francis and Mario get together and start talking about this subject, anywhere near it and around it, it's still in them, and there's something that stimulates them about it. And, you know, Francis is a good example of that saying, man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? Heard about three throughout these years, but Francis saying he was going to do it, But Francis is funny that way. You know, he'll give you little hints about things, and he'll give you a little hint, and he throws it out. He's, you know, I don't know, maybe I'm going to do this, but they want me to do this, you know, and then you say, uh-oh, he's planning something. That's a couple of years before it happens, too.
Well, one of the things he does that's so brilliant, several, 2 months before we started this film, he brought the cast to Napa Valley, to his home.
I'm interrupting you. Like, we would like to rewrite the scene.
And to his little studio on the outskirts of San Francisco. And we sat around, we read the script, we talked, and he's brilliant at it. Brilliant.
No, I understand, but it still is the end. I mean, you.
But we
got
to do that step first before we
do.
We're going to have 4 hours of emotion, but it's going to all happen in 4 minutes because I have many things to resolve. I have you, I have you, I have the other one, I have the other one, and it all has to be like one great emotional thing.
Yeah, but it's like, how does it end? How does it end?
One, see, take four, AV cameras.
Have a party, folks, and background.
Hey, have a lot of fun.
This last film is more than a number after a title. It's not Godfather 3. It's the continuing saga of this Corleone family, of this march through life that Francis is investigating.
You know, Michael, now that you're so respectable, I think you're more dangerous than you ever were. In fact, I preferred you when you were just a common mafia hood.
Okay. Now, can we talk common sense here?
All right.
Okay.
Tony knows that you killed Fredo.
Michael's always been the kind of a character to me that made a choice early on when he said he was going to go with his father to protect his father. And from that point on has, paid for it. I spent my life protecting my family!
Let's be reasonable, okay? That's your big thing, isn't it, Michael? Reason? Backed up by murder?
Oh, God. Don't you hate me? You hate me?
No, I don't hate you. I dread you.
I did what I could, Kay, to protect all of you from the horrors of this world.
But you became my horror.
I've always felt Michael had a kind of a disdain for gangsterism. He's looking for a kind of a face so that he can turn everything back. He wants to turn it back the way it was before it all started. You know, it's always before he got into this kind of trouble. I mean, he bit, you know what I mean? He bit, and it's a lifetime. It's really, can you go back again?
Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
There's a lot of fear in Michael. I think somewhere he understands now by three.
Our true enemy has not yet shown his face.
Three now is about how to sort of cope with all that's happened and pave the way for the third generation.
Michael, this is Vincent Mancini, Sonny's boy.
How you doing, Mr. Corleone?
How you doing?
I'm doing good. How you doing? Good party.
Oh, you like it?
Yeah, I had to sneak in.
Well, you're dressed for it.
I don't think Francis knew who I was. He says that it was his Paramount was suggesting some kid, you know, the Paramount suggestion, you know.
Mark.
Who do they want now, you know, for the part? Because apparently he had some wild suggestions from before, you know, and who was going to play Michael Corleone, so.
Remember Vincent who was this guy? Mancini?
Is he Spanish? Who do they?
But they all work out at the end.
Early on in Napa, we were just going through readings. Francis had kind of conceived Vincent as a combination of all the brothers and the grandfather. He had kind of the temper of Sonny and.
And then they will fear you.
Smarts of Vito. and kind of the calculations of Michael. And the warmth of Fredo.
What's the trouble between you and Mr. Joseph?
Just trouble. I'll take care of it.
It's foolish of you.
Foolish of me? Things a little foolish of this guy, don't you think? Right?
Vincent.
Right?
Temper like his father.
When I finally did Godfather 2, I tried to end it. And then I felt, well, it's over, basta. And went on my way. And then I kept hearing, oh, they want to make another Godfather. I said, well, that's fine to want to make it. But, you know, about what? I pretty much mined the emotional material of that family. And it's not like other kinds of sequels where you just then, like Sherlock Holmes, drum up another adventure.
Francis never said no to me, which encouraged me, because I always kind of thought that there is going to be a moment in time when he is going to want to do it.
I said the only Godfather film I would do after this is, you know, Abbott and Costello meets the Godfather, you know, and you have the Abbott and Costello and, hey, Abbott, the guy is over, you know.
We talked to actors like John Travolta, Sly Stallone. I mean, it took all kinds of permutations.
Then, of course, they were all thinking, well, Michael would have a son and he would go on and et cetera, et cetera.
It became a Las Vegas story, became an Atlantic City story in the casinos there.
But for me, the tragedy of The Godfather, which is the tragedy of America, is about Michael Corleone. By the end of Godfather 2, just like America in that period, Michael had become wrapped in kind of self-righteousness and just distrusted everyone. And
getting more and more like a you know, paranoid person, like a Nixon.
There's no doubt that there's a thug sort of lurking somewhere in Michael, but something that he doesn't really cater to or admit to. And even if he does admit to it at times, it's not something he's comfortable with.
Don't ever again give that kind of order. Not while I'm alive. I command this family, right or wrong. It was not what I wanted!
I think one of the reasons Francis was ready to do this third film is that he really did have something he wanted to say, something about a man in his middle age looking back on his life, reflecting on his successes, on his failures, reflecting on his mortality, reflecting on his family and what he would be leaving his family, his heritage. And these are things that are very much on Francis's mind now.
In Godfather 3, the difference is that Michael, who is looking for a kind of redemption, his tone is, rather than conspiratorial, it becomes confessional.
The thing we're asking for is the very thing that the film is asking for, is to be able to get closer to his feelings. You know, that he's such a insulated guy, Michael Corleone.
He's so more disgusted with himself than another guy would be.
So then the question is, if he did all these terrible things, maybe his heart gave him up, maybe his heart didn't protect him. He wanted to always do murder, do murder, do murder. Did he jump to the murder solution too soon? Michael Corleone has a conscience, and he's in pain because now he sees that wherever he goes, death follows. And this old man is only dead because he tried to help Michael Corleone. Everyone is dead in his wake. Scene is inspired by Dean Tavalaris's and Arthur Penn's work in Bonnie and Clyde. Kurosawa is the father of all violence in modern movie. Kurosawa via Arthur Penn and Bonnie and Clyde and Sam Peckinpah. So there is a certain way to treat violence, this more gory way that really comes ultimately from Shakespeare.
How many takes? One.
Yeah, I had 147 squibs on me. Just before we're about to go, he's wiring me and he goes, I never put this many squibs on a guy in my life. I said, I don't think it was necessary for you to tell me that now.
There was always one weird detail. There was always some little weird detail before the violence happens. Remember, like in Godfather 2, when the light bulb is out and the towel catches fire, or some little thing that causes you to remember, even though it may be very, very short.
Got the idea from someone who told me about how they had heard this is how people in that situation would wrap a towel around a pistol and do this kind of slaying execution or whatever.
Rome, one day there was some Italian holiday and they said, well, the Monday is closed. I said, closed? You know, we got our whole people here, we got a lot of work to do. So we invented cafe production. We just went to the Via Veneto and we got set up on around, you know, this big long table, and we just did our day's work sitting in a cafe. And I remember in that session we were going through everything, and we had the idea, well, what if in the middle of this big kind of summit meeting in Atlantic City, and all of a sudden all the table started shaking and everyone thought it was like an earthquake, and then all of a sudden a helicopter was killing everyone, except you never saw the helicopter.
Let's go.
Let's get out of here. Wait, wait. Let's go.
That he wanted not to see the helicopter as a helicopter, but to see it from the point of view of the people being killed, which is just that there's something up there, which might be a helicopter, which is, you know, raining fire down on us. So he just wanted to keep it mysterious.
As I said, there's always some little weird detail. In the first Godfather, I think it was, we had the guy get shot in the eye, which was disgusting. But it was startling. And I wanted to do something at the end that was like that, but, you know, it was a political figure, and the person who went in was totally unarmed and had been through detectors, and yet he had to be able to kill him.
See, violence is a very difficult thing for Francis in a way, because he really does not like violence and doesn't like the violent aspects of the Godfather films. And therefore, when he is going to do something violent in one of the films, he always tries to find a way to do it that's a little different than what you've seen before. To have the actor simply go up there and break the guy's neck was a little tame and expected. Francis, later on in post-production, came up with a different idea of how to do it, one that most of us probably have not seen before, one that may or may not even practically be possible.
And I got this idea, you know, from Kurosawa. What if the guy just took, because this character wore big heavy glasses, just took his glasses and just ripped his aorta open with the glass, because he knew he would be wearing the glasses.
Like he always says, like a gush of blood, you know, and all that. Could kill him with a pencil. I don't want to kill him with a pencil.
Spade! Okay, Antonio?
Yeah.
Okay.
Ready?
Action!
Creva!
Spade!
Pulse it!
Stop the blood!
Un momentino di più.
in the original cut of The Glasses Killing, which was first presented to the censors.
You got a Polaroid of that?
We were given an NC-17 rating for the Godfather film, unless we were willing to trim back the spurt, and therefore we did so for the final release of the film. The actual sort of real blood Catholic ritualistic aspect of the killing was sort of lost a little by having to censor it.
When I was a kid, my dad conducted a production of Cavalry Rooster Caan. I used to go a lot with my father, and sometimes he would let me sit in the orchestra pit next to him. I remember four or five things just impressed me so much. One was the idea that these men had an argument and then one bit the other's ear and drew blood, and that that was a Sicilian way to do a duel, and it meant it would be a duel to the death.
Come on, Vincent. Come. Make your peace.
He basically told me a brief history of, you know, how this fits in the operatic sense. Here are these two men making their peace, and then the one guy crosses the line for a second by throwing in that one little, has to say that one little derogatory comment about his origin.
Bastardo.
And boom, next thing you know, the guy's clamping onto his ear.
The first take, I guess I missed the mark, and I was a little, you know, carried away. And when I ripped, and I actually ripped the entire prosthesis off his ear, and some of his hair, actually. And Francis liked the fact that I was taking the ear, the bits of ear still were in my mouth. Like that, he said, I like that, I like that. Do we have any hot dogs or anything that he could put in his mouth? Everything was always, you know, up for grabs, you know. It was only, the only thing that was sacred was what, in fact, was in the Caan. And if it wasn't in the Caan, it could change the next day. I mean, I think Dean Tavolaris said that with Francis, the script is like a newspaper and no one comes out every day.
This is a conspiracy, that it's got to have the feeling of a conspiracy being unraveled and bam, the solution is made and you guys are going to fight back.
You arrange a meeting. You say how devoted you are to me. You tell him your problems. You ask for his help.
What problems?
That you want to run away with my daughter. Only you know that if you do, I will become your enemy.
With Francis, when he gets set up in something, he's always going to go and he's going to reach. And he's going to go try to go further than he did before. I knew when he said he was going to do it, when he first said it, it was 2 years before he said he was going to do it, because I think he had to ruminate about it. And then finally, when it did come, he had, I think, something he wanted to talk about.
That one is two or three scenes that are breakthrough scenes. But I need to have the scene be like where people get a little nervous. We're into very subtle guilt stuff here, because who ultimately, if he's just sworn in the life of his kids that he won't sin again, does he sin again? It's the sin of omission. He doesn't stop him. But he's like really up a pickle here.
Very tricky.
Yeah, but it's interesting. It's evil against good at this point over there, and it's a real enigma he's caught in.
Pop. What would you do now? We had the same dream. Pop, what would you do now? When he reaches out to his father, I mean, what could his father give him at this point? What wisdom is he looking for?
This wasn't enough time, Michael. Wasn't enough time.
We'll get there, Pop.
We'll get there.
Maybe the guy thought he loved his family so much, but maybe he was always a loner, and that's why he couldn't really, you know, he became too much the head of the family in his mind and not enough in his heart. You know, a real father, a real family member always does what's good for the family. See ya. Taking your picture.
I always really treasured the times with the family and loved all of them very much. I always thought that those get-togethers with my uncles and my cousins always were high points to me. And I learned to turn to them when I was in trouble, and I reached out wherever I could to, for those things that I knew were definite because I had lived that way. And as the movies were made one after another, more and more, The Godfather became just kind of the biggest home movie in history. And my attitude was, why not have Tally play the part, because maybe it'll be good for her.
You know who that was on the phone? Your girlfriend! She couldn't make it tonight, you know? What's for dinner? What do you mean, what's for dinner? Did you hear what I said to you?
So you know what I did the first day when I went on the set the first day? I walked into the camera and knocked it down. And because I didn't wear my glasses and I was so nervous. And Marlon Brando was there. I walked right smack. I mean, and he came over to see if I was okay because it was a very large, so naturally, the first day, the sister knocks the camera down.
Why not have my father get his break so he can write the music? And why not put my little baby in the baptism scene? At least I'll have always a memory of that. It'll be like a home movie. I'll always be able to see what my kids look like.
Well, I remember one time we were in New York, Little Italy, and we were sitting in the back of the old St. Patrick's Cathedral in Little Italy. We were shooting some of the scenes. And he just happened to lean over to me, and I remember him saying, he says, you know, this is the church where we shot the baptism in part one. And I looked around, and I says, oh, wow. You know, and I got kind of a little chill. I thought, this is great. Oh, this is that same church. I didn't know that. And he says, yeah, I see. You see up on the altar there, the baptismal font? He says, yeah, oh, that's fantastic. That's right. Oh, that's where they baptize a little baby. Then he says, now you see my daughter Sophia over there standing next to the baptismal font, which she was, you know. So I look over at Sophia, who's about 19 years old now. As I'm looking at her, he says to me, she was the baby. And it was like, whoa, it gave me that little, you know, it made the hair stand up on my neck for a second.
Diane Keaton looked to me like she really hadn't held a child before, because I kept seeing Sophia's head sort of falling off her arm, and it was all I could do to keep from running up there and sort of propping her head up.
I'm your little cousin.
When my dad was writing the script, you know, he naturally based it on when he's writing about a daughter, he based some of it on me.
Who's your father?
I'll give you a hint. He's Italian.
Mary.
At the beginning, Mary. I remember going to Diane Keaton and saying, like, oh, my God, I have to do this kissing scene with Anne in front of my dad, blah, blah, blah. And she said, like, and I was, like, really scared to do it. I just did not want to do it. And she said, oh, no, they're fun. They're really fun to do, like, love scenes. Because you get to, like, do all the things you're not supposed to do, which you can't really do. So then it was fun.
Cut. Very nice.
The Godfather was textured or perfumed in a way by our memories of our Italian-American family around the ping-pong table eating or the wedding.
Greatest choice in the world, and the thing that made that picture was the fact that Francis is so family-oriented. It's almost like you forgave everybody everything because they did it for the sake of family.
So that part is important, that Coppola showed that. The family side of that, that's the beginning and the end of the world is a family and love and companionship. You know, no matter what lifestyle you choose, whether it be gangster, politician, or schoolteacher, or whatever.
That's just part of his nature, to have a family thing. And he made the film, the whole style of it and everything. He personalized it in a way that he could understand, so that it would, so it has a warmth, it has a romanticism about it. That's its trademark almost, you know. his personal life was carried over into the film and vice versa. It sort of overlapped.
Well, it does seem like he draws a lot from his personal life, family experience. Then, of course, people tell me that there's something related to Kay and myself. It's the WASP wife who is not Italian, not really a member of the family, it's always a little on the outside, excluded. Diane recently said to me that, yes, she was modeling the role on me, and I'm always a little startled to think that there's that much similarity.
It is natural to feel like a band of actors or a band of a family. You know, it occurs besides, of course, Francis additionally trying to have people come together with dinners and rehearsal periods, which are really nothing more than creating kinfolk out of each other.
My idea is that when a cast early on can do something sort of sensual together, eat together, or in some way really participate together, that they get certain kind of bias that stays with them. And then much later, when you're in a scene and something happens, that comes out and accounts for the kind of realistic response, because the preparation has, you know, prepared them for it.
In the beginning, we went to up near Patsy's up in East Harlem, and we all sat around. We sat, you know, in positions at the dinner table as if it were the fictional family.
And I had Marlon sitting at the head of the table, and next to him was Jimmy Caan. On the other side was Bobby Duval, and my sister Talia was serving the homemade style food.
My job as the kid was to set the table. In my male family, I wasn't allowed to talk. But it was the right improvisation that was a very correct technique on Francis's part. He started to create the family around the dinner table.
And little by little, you know, Jimmy Caan was showing off, trying to impress Marlon and with his jokes, and Al was looking intense and trying to impress Marlon with his kind of sensitivity.
So we got to know each other, you know, kind of like a family outside the fictional frame, and naturally, if you're relaxed and loose and open, whatever, that's going to carry over.
As Brenda was talking, Duval was for some reason making these mimicking faces of him, and so I moved away just to. So I thought, well, it's good for my character.
Brando and I sat by ourselves off in the corner and had a few glasses of wine, a couple, maybe too many. And he said, hey, "Jimmy, let me ask you something. If you know, if you could have anything you wanted, you know, anything, what would it be, you know?" So I was feeling in my cups myself, and I said, I don't know, maybe, you know, be in love, you know. Jeez, he goes, me too. Don't tell my wife, you know.
Everyone was doing what the roles were. They were doing it, and you knew you were doing it in a crazy kind of way, and you couldn't help it. Because I thought, what else are we here? I mean, we'd never be here anyway if it wasn't for the movie.
Action! Azione!
Well, Godfather 3 was a little different because, you know, it was 18 years later or 16 years later, and everyone had become famous and rich, and just to get them all in one place was tough.
You know what's so interesting about this movie, too, at least to me, I found this kind of mind-crushing deja vu, because we take this whole group of people, and then you're all standing there looking at each other on a location, dealing with a place, and dealing with actors you dealt with 20 years earlier, you know, and it's staggering, and you rarely get an opportunity ever, not rarely, you don't get an opportunity ever to do a thing like that.
When you bring back the whole crew from the previous pictures and you're using old collaborators who knew each other over many years, who had gotten old together, who had learned together, has to have some flavor that will influence the theme, because it is about a family being made by a family.
I said to Ellie years ago, and it's very true, I said, we're the Voilanders. We're the most dangerous act in town. But you know, something about a circus family is that you can do the difficult stunts with your own family. Whatever goes on, what you're supposed to in the development and in the rivalries and the joys and the memories. If it's a family member and you're doing a triple, they'll catch you.
Everyone look toward me, nice.
So much of the way we work with the collaborators is in that way that has to sort of influence the movie.
And try to smile, will you, Vincent? And go!
Creating the possible things that could happen, the accidents that would happen.
Cake,
I remember one scene in which the Godfather was supposed to die, and we had a break for lunch, and there was like about an hour left. We put up two cameras that time, and we just said, well, this little kid didn't want to play with Marlon, didn't want to do the scene, and if we didn't get it and we broke for lunch, that would be the end of the light, and we would never get it. So Marlon had an idea. He says, look, let me show you this. He took the orange peel, put it in his mouth, and I said, let's just roll because we got to go to lunch. He's mad because we're losing the light. He said, let's just do it. So we rolled with two cameras, and sure enough, Marlon put the orange peel. And if you see the shots, you see how there's an accident. The kid reacted and ran around. And so sometimes you catch lightning in a bottle. I mean, that's what you hope to do. Fundamental in the story, if Michael really could talk to his father, let's say Michael went to heaven, and there he was greeted by Don Vito Corleone, and he says, Pop, I'm here. How did I do? And the father says, you forgot one thing. And he says, what? He said, whatever I did, I always listened to my heart. And Michael said, I did too. Let him stay in the mood. Let's go. Just like that, standing by the roll.
Good, my old friend. We won all our battles, didn't we, you and I?
Don Tomasino, we won all our battles, you and I. And to what purpose? My family still is in danger. You and your coffin, only 90, you could have lived a little longer. And I could be nearer to my dreams.
You could have lived longer. I could be closer to my dreams.
Feel like after Sonny died, kind of that weakness, being wounded.
Because it's like pain to it.
It's so interesting. Francis just can give you a narrative. I mean, he can stand there all day and tell you what the characters are thinking. This is so unusual. There may be more Michael and Francis there are than me.
I won all my battles and still I failed. Maybe he kind of sobs a little bit at that moment.
It's at this point, everything now is different. I think even to the point of saying I swear on the life of my children.
Why was I so feared?
How did your virtues become my sins?
What was it?
Why was I feared while you were loved?
I was no less honorable.
I wanted to do good.
I tried to do good. What betrayed me?
What betrayed me? My mind?
My heart?
Or was it my heart? I swear on the lives of my children, give me this one last chance to redeem myself. And I will sin no more.
No more. Tell me. Tell me, Don Tomasino. Why I so condemned myself? Why? What betrayed me? My heart, my mind.
That kiss is like a guitar string. Like that, it had a 1-2, but if it could just, you know, have the one.
Okay. Want to get out of that heavy thing again. That's good.
What it is the natural evolution. The film crew itself is a family that goes through three generations. The story is going through three generations. In life, if you put yourself in harmony with the natural way of things, you get a much better result than if you try to go against that.
Italian-American family.
Yeah, it starts to come.
Yeah. We got to him.
Oh, we got that. I like that worked good when you played, that you hadn't been let up for like 20 years. You've had this responsibility and the old.
The thing that's different about Godfather 3 and Godfather 2 is that Michael is different. But in order to see how he's different, we got to get a few tastes of it. Because we need a little emotion. If we could put a little emotion, like in three places in the movie, that would be the thing.
Just have the weight of the gravity. That's what does it. You know what I'm saying is that you've never, from the time you committed that first sin, you've never had the weight off of you. Okay? Well, and you must have. You can't take it anymore.
Okay.
Just to be different.
It seems to me that whatever the film lay in a balance, that And if I kicked it one side and kicked it to be more personal and more even soap opera or more emotional, that would be enough to kick it over, you know?
The audience has got to be like this during this thing, you know? I mean, it's got to be, Jesus, this guy is cracking. This guy is, for the first time, I know he's really worried that he did the wrong thing. I mean, he's got a conscience. I mean, how can we put the intensity of that in this moment alone? You see, there's no one in the room except this corpse. So he can speak freely, and I mean, you almost could see him by the coffin being very emotional. And then he says, "Where did I go wrong?" is what he's saying. Or did it? Is it too late for me? Are my sins too great? Did I love too much or too little?
There's a point, like, you know, you get a virtuous man and he commits an unvirtuous act. He's so horrified that he's committed that unvirtuous act that it becomes even more terrible. In a sense,
the only trouble is these are all intellectual ideas, yeah. And we're trying to get
a visual,
something really just emotional that the guy's speaking from his heart. I mean, he's a guy who's clearly getting ready for death, and he's very worried that he—it's like King Lear. He hasn't set things right.
My history with The Godfather was very much the history of someone in trouble. I found the first movie very tough to do and very tough to finally pull off. I was a young director. I hadn't really done a lot of work, and I had this opportunity to do this novel. I thought of myself as a professional director making that.
Impressive, there are than me.
I won all my battles and still I failed. Maybe he kind of sobs a little bit at that moment.
It's at this point everything now is different. I think even to the point of saying I swear on the life of my children.
Why was I so feared?
How did your virtues become my sins?
What was it?
Why was I feared while you were loved?
I was no less honorable.
I wanted to do good.
I tried to do good. What betrayed me?
What betrayed me? My mind?
My heart?
Or was it my heart? I swear on the lives of my children, give me this one last chance to redeem myself. I will sin no more.
No more.
Why I so condemned myself? Why? What betrayed me? My heart, my mind.
That kiss is like a guitar string. Like that, it had a 1-2, but if it could just, you know, have the one.
Okay. Want to get out of that heavy thing again. That's good.
Why
was I feared while you were loved. I was no less honorable.
I wanted to do good.
I tried to do good. What betrayed me?
What betrayed me? My mind?
My heart?
Or was it my heart? I swear on the lives of my children, give me this one last chance to redeem myself. And I will sin no more.
No more. Tell me. Tell me about Tomasino. Why I so condemned myself. Why? What betrayed me? My heart, my mind.
That kiss is like a guitar string. Like that, it had a 1-2, but if it could just, you know, have the one.
Okay. Want to get out of that heavy thing again. That's good.
Evolution is the encouragement.
And when I think of the Godfathers, I think of Michael in that hat walking along the gravel. Because that was a real turning point. Remember when Carlo is being garroted in the car and it does, and then afterward he walks with the three guys? That's the image for me.
See, Michael was so wrapped in the fact that he was right, that what he was doing was right, that it blinded him and it blighted his heart. In other words, was I so sure that I was right that I, you know, I mean, that's why he says, did my heart betray me?
This time, don't say give one more chance, just say give me the chance to redeem myself, if you can remember.
See, anything that could show Michael really turning on himself.
Can we go?
I mean, the guy is really worried that he maybe is a bad man.
Finally, he's torn between good and evil. I mean, he is literally torn apart.
Maybe he's talking about one thing and then he...
I think when Francis and Mario get together and start talking about this subject, anywhere near and around it, it's still in them, and there's something that stimulates them about it. And, you know, Francis is a good example of that saying, man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? Heard about three throughout these years, but Francis saying he was going to do it. But Francis is funny that way. You know, he'll give you little hints about things, and he'll give you a little hint, and he throws it out. He says, you know, I don't know, maybe I'm going to do this, but then they want me to do this, you know, and then you say, he's planning something. That's a couple of years before it happens, too.
Well, one of the things he does that's so brilliant, several
2 months before we started this film, he brought the cast to Napa Valley, to his home.
I'm interrupting you. Like, we would like to rewrite the scene.
And to his little studio on the outskirts of San Francisco. And we sat around, we read the script, we talked. And he's brilliant at it, brilliant.
No, I understand, but it still is the end. I mean, you
want to do that step first before we do.
We're going to have 4 hours of emotion, but it's going to all happen in 4 minutes because I have many things to resolve. I have you, I have you, I have the other one, I have the other one, and it all has to be like one great emotional thing.
Yeah, but it's like, how does it end? How does it end?
Take 4, A and B cameras.
Have a party, folks, and background.
Hey, have a lot of fun.
This last film is
the first take, I guess I missed the mark, and I was a little, you know, carried away. And when I ripped, and I actually ripped the entire prosthesis off his ear, and some of his hair, actually. And Francis liked the fact that I was taking the ear, the bits of ear still were in my mouth, like that. He said, I like that, I like that. Do we have any hot dogs or anything that he could put in his mouth? Everything was always, you know, up for grabs, you know. It was only, the only thing that was sacred was what, in fact, was in the can. And if it wasn't in the can, it could change the next day. I mean, I think Dean Tavolaris said that with Francis, the script is like a newspaper and no one comes out every day.
This is a conspiracy, that it's got to have the feeling of a conspiracy being unraveled and bam, the solution is made and you guys are going to fight back.
You arrange a meeting. You say how devoted you are to me. You tell him your problems. You ask for his help.
What problems?
That you want to run away with my daughter. Only you know that if you do, I will become your enemy.
With Francis, when he gets set up in something, he's always going to go, and he's going to reach, and he's going to go try to go further than he did before. I knew when he said he was going to do it, when he first said it, it was 2 years before he said he was going to do it, because I think he had to ruminate about it. And then finally, when it did come, he had, I think, something he wanted to talk about.
I want to shoot 2 or 3 scenes that are breakthrough scenes. But I need to have the scene be like where people get a little nervous. We're into very subtle guilt stuff here, because who ultimately, if he's just sworn in the life of his kids that he won't sin again, does he sin again? It's the sin of omission. He doesn't stop him. But he's like really up a pickle here.
Very tricky.
Yeah, but it's interesting.
Oh, it's evil against good at this point over there. And it's a real enigma he's caught in.
Pop. What would you do now? We had the same dream. Pop, what would you do now?
Refuse any request.
For some reason, they were not happy with Al's test. But I knew Francis wanted Al.
And 104. Action.
I was aware that they didn't want me. And
Mike, why are all those people bothering?
At one point, and it was actually, you know, it seemed okay finally. I thought, Francis, look, I mean, we'll do another movie together. I was relatively young, so I didn't know quite. I thought, well, maybe they were all like this. You know, they get all. I had seen movies about Hollywood. I thought maybe that's why all the screen tests.
Well, this is a slow wedding. This isn't a wedding.
One night, I got a call from Francis. He was in New York, and he said, Jimmy, and I could tell from his voice this was not his idea. Jimmy, why don't you come in and test? I said, test what? What, do you got a Porsche you want me to drive around the block? What do you want? Test what? He said, please, they want you to play Michael. Why? Please. So I went in.
168. Action.
Michael? Why are all those people bothering your father on a day like this?
Well, that's because they know no Sicilian can refuse a request on his daughter's wedding day.
Oh, good.
I don't think you can name an actor that wasn't there. They were all sitting around on cement floors from 7 in the morning to late at night. Guys with, you know, some guys talk like this, you know. I mean, that guy's from all over the world.
They tried to kill him, my father. They did. They nearly did. Mr. Brazzi went after them. And so the story goes.
The story goes that he killed 6 men in 2 weeks. He killed 6 men in 2 weeks. 6 men in 1 week.
And he kept sneaking Al in, you know. At the end of the day, he kept testing Al, you know.
It kept happening a lot. And it was countless. They went on and on. I remember saying at the time, you know, I just don't respond well to being around where I'm not wanted. Well, anyway, he just stayed with it. It was his tenacity, and that got me in there.
Luca Brazzi held a gun to his head, and my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract. It's a true story.
And a little point of memorabilia, that was Marsha Lucas, who was the editor, George's wife, who cut those tests all together. And she told me that, she said, cast Al Pacino because he undresses you with his eyes.
Marsha said that.
Yeah.
She was right.
And Diane said,
you hate me.
No, I don't hate you. I dread you.
I did what I could, Kay, to protect all of you from the horrors of this world.
But you became my whore.
I've always felt Michael had a kind of a disdain for gangsterism. He's looking for a kind of a face so that he can turn everything back. He wants to turn it back the way it was before it all started. You know, it's always before he got into this kind of trouble. I mean, he bit, you know what I mean? He bit, and it's a lifetime. It's really, can you go back again?
Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
There's a lot of fear in Michael. I think somewhere he understands now by 3.
Our true enemy has not yet shown his face.
3 now is about how to sort of cope with all that's happened and pave the way for the 3rd generation.
Michael, this is Vincent Mancini, Sonny's boy.
How you doing, Mr. Corleone?
How you doing?
I'm doing good. How you doing? Good party.
Oh, you like it?
Yeah, I had to sneak in.
Well, you're dressed for it.
I don't think Francis knew who I was. He says that he says Paramount was suggesting some kid, you know, the Paramount suggestion. You know.
Mark.
Who do they want now, you know, for the part? Because apparently he had some wild suggestions from before, you know, and who was going to play Michael Corleone, so.
Remember Vincent, who was this guy? Mancini?
Is he Spanish? Who do they?
But they all work out at the end.
Early on in Napa. We were just going through readings. Francis had kind of conceived Vincent as a combination of all the brothers and the grandfather. He had kind of the temper of Sonny
and then there were failure.
Smarts of Vito. Kind of the calculations of Michael. And the warmth of Fredo.
What's the trouble between you and Mr. Joseph?
Just trouble. I'll take care of it.
It's foolish of you.
Foolish of me? Things a little foolish of this guy, don't you think? Right?
Vincent.
Right?
Temper like his father.
When I finally did Godfather 2, I tried to end it. And then I felt, well, it's over, basta. And went on my way.
Suicide.
that becomes even more terrible. In the sense,
the only trouble is these are all intellectual ideas, yeah, and we're trying to get
a visual,
something really just emotional that the guy's speaking from his heart. I mean, he's a guy who's clearly getting ready for death, and he's very worried that he, it's like King Lear, he hasn't set things right.
My history with The Godfather was very much the history of someone in trouble. I found the first movie very tough to do and very tough to finally pull off. I was a young director. I hadn't really done a lot of work, and I had this opportunity to do this novel. I thought of myself as a professional director making an adaptation of a novel. I knew that as the book became more popular and more successful, I realized that in a sense it was beginning to outclass me, in that I wouldn't have gotten the job had, you know, 5 months later the book become the sensation that it was. And even in the early weeks of the production, I knew that they were not happy with what I had done. The kind of classic style that I chose in rushes maybe didn't impress them. But I just wanted to survive it. I knew that my ideas regarding the casting were not popular. Had been a very difficult time to try to convince the studio that my notions about casting were right.
I remember he having a lot of he was having a lot of problems. Every time he mentioned Brando's name, one of the executives is the right word, said, if you mention his name again, you're out.
And the guy who was then the president said, as president of Paramount Pictures, these are his exact words, as president of Paramount Pictures, Marlon Brando will never appear in this motion picture.
Let me lay it on the line for you and your boss, whoever he is. Johnny Fontaine will never get that movie.
I remember I just sort of fell on the floor and said to them, you know, at least give me a chance. They're all right. If, number one, he does the movie for nothing, if he does a screen test, and if he puts up a bond guaranteeing that he, none of his shenanigans will cost a delay, you can consider him. So I said, all right. And I called up Brandon, whom I didn't know, and, you know, had made that contact, and said, oh, what if I do some makeup tests, I said, you know, to get around the screen test. And I went and I brought Italian cheese and cigars and stuff. And we were just shooting and shooting, and he saw the cheese and went like that, and he started to like take his hair and put shoe polish on. He says, it's like a bulldog, and puts on his hand. He says, I want to have, you know. And he's doing this right there, and I'm shooting it, and then like he started going, he put Kleenex in his mouth, and he had black. It's remarkable to see.
Buonasera. Buonasera. What have I ever done to make you treat me so?
Send a violence director in to kind of come in and do the violence.
It's funny.
I went that night with my sister Tally and my little boy Gio to the set, and we with Gio playing Carlo, who was like 8 years old, 9 years old, and Tally being there. I think I may have had a video camera, but I went in there and said, okay, violence.
You just told me to make you dinner.
Hey, Bafangul, huh?
And we went down and we rehearsed it, and we thought how interesting it would be if she was pregnant and pitiful and hid behind the curtain and
knock down all the dishes. Then you go over there and knock down all the vases. Then Gio, go in there. Here's this little boy going in with the strap hitting his hand. Now run to it. Now break the window. Now crash the thing, you know. At that scene, you see the scene directed by a man who knew a violence director was coming.
Yeah. And Francis is very open, you know, to there were a few scenes. I remember once at the beginning of the picture, I asked the prop master to cut a industrial broom handle off and put it in my car. He said, Jimmy, it's not in the script anyway. I said, so what? I mean, it's just put it there, you know. And sure enough, you know, when I got out of the car, it wasn't scripted, and Francis didn't expect it when I fired it at Gianni Russo.
Come here, come here.
But De Niro tried out for the part of Sonny. And he did. We shot a test on De Niro, which I think exists, that was so electrifying.
I
think I did. Did I do the screen test for Sonny? Yeah. Me and 4,000 other people or whatever, we all came in.
You're going to take both of them out on me. You're going to take them. And you know what they're going to do to you? And you know what you do when you knock somebody off? You take a gun, you shoot him right up against his fucking head. That's what you do. You get his brains all over your nice new Ivy League suit, Michael. That's what happens. How do you like that?
It was spectacular, but it was Sonny really like killer, you know, like nothing you could ever sell.
I know you can do it. All right, you prove it to me. You can do it. Go ahead, prove it.
Hey, what are you going to do? Nice college boy, huh? Didn't want to get mixed up in the family business? Huh? Now you want to gun down a police captain? Why, because he slapped you in the face a little bit? Huh? What do you think, this is the army where you shoot him a mile away? You got to get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit. Come in.
The pet lovers, when they protested that, is we ordered it from the same source where to get the pet food.
We wanted a horse that matched the real horse, right? And then we had to put, even then, we had to put a certain diamond pattern on the head.
You know, I just remember about that thing is that we did that, we kept this head on ice for a while, obviously, yeah, because I remember the day we shot the scene, it was extremely hot out, and John Marley stayed in bed with his horse's head in this heat. It was a little tacky, actually, for...
The funny thing about the horse's head is that when I read the book, I read it wrong. I thought that the horse was in the bed with him, and he looked at the sheets, and... Right. But now as I read it, that's the way it is in the movie.
All right.
In reality, in the book, the horse was there. The horse's head was there right in front when he got up. He looked at it, and that little misreading left...
It wasn't in the bed?
It led me to suggest. I said, Bertie, what if he discovers it?
He wakes up, he feels
black.
Finally, and then there it is.
But that wasn't the way the book was, but I misread it that way.
Godfather became just kind of the biggest home movie in history.
Just a man that doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man.
You gotta get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit.
Never take sides with anyone against the family again.
We're both part of the same hypocrisy. But never think it applies to my family.
Movies were very new to me, and Duval would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take.
It's because I admire you, and I love you, and I kept things secret from you.
Just have the weight of the gravity, that's what does it. You know what I'm saying is that you've never, from the time you committed that first sin, you've never had the weight off of you. Okay, well, and you must, that you can't take it anymore.
Okay.
It has to be different. It seems to me that whatever the film lay in a balance, and if I kicked it one side and kicked it to being more personal and more even soap opera or more emotional, that would be enough to kick it over, you know? The audience has got to be like this during this thing, you know? I mean, it's got to be, Jesus, this guy is cracking. This guy is, for the first time, I know he's really worried that he did the wrong thing. I mean, he's got a conscience. I mean, how can we put the intensity of that in this moment alone? You see, there's no one in the room except this corpse. So he can speak freely, and I mean, you almost could see him by the coffin being very emotional.
And then he says, where did I go wrong, is what he's saying. But, or did it, is it too late for me? Are my sins too great? Did I love too much or too little?
There's a point, like, you know, you get a virtuous man and he commits an unvirtuous act. He's so horrified that he's committed that unvirtuous act that becomes even more terrible. In a sense,
the only trouble is these are all intellectual ideas, yeah. And we're trying to get
a visual.
Something really just emotional that the guy's speaking from his heart. I mean, he's a guy who's clearly getting ready for death, and he's very worried that he—it's like King Lear. He hasn't set things right.
My history with The Godfather was very much the history of someone in trouble. I found the first movie very tough to do and very tough to finally pull off. I was a young director. I hadn't really done a lot of work, and I had this opportunity to do this novel. I thought of myself as a professional director making an adaptation of a novel. I knew that as the book became more popular and more successful, I realized that in a sense it was beginning to outclass me, in that I wouldn't have gotten the job had, you know, 5 months later the book become the sensation that it was. And even in the early weeks of the production, I knew that they were not happy with what I had done. The kind of classic style that I chose in rushes maybe didn't impress them. But I just wanted to survive it. I knew that my ideas regarding the casting were not popular. Had been a very difficult time to try to convince the studio that my notions about casting were right.
I remember he having a lot of he was having a lot of problems. Every time he mentioned Brando's name, one of the...
When you see our mother, I want to know a day in advance so I won't be there. You understand?
Mikey.
Generally, making The Godfather, the first Godfather, was just like nonstop anxiety and, you know, wondering when I was going to get fired. And
we had two kids, and I was pregnant with a third. And it was like kind of a horrifying time, because it seemed like at any moment the whole thing would collapse. And
I remember once being in the men's room, and, some crew members came in and they were talking, what a piece of junk, and that guy doesn't know what he's doing.
No one knew when you were going to be fired on that first movie. And so the thing is, just get enough footage in the can, you know. Keep going, keep shooting.
When I look back at the pleasure of it, it's I guess the pleasure looking back is the thing. That's the pleasure, that you're able to look back and that you survived.
During the first few weeks of Godfather 1, I gained a great deal of respect for him. For what he had to go through, what Paramount was putting him through with a second director following him around in case he was fired, you're out, this guy goes right in. And that's a fact.
When I hear people talk about how they've liked some of those films years later, or that they were wonderful films, all I can think of is, I wish I'd heard it then, because I could have sure used the encouragement.
When I think of The Godfathers, I think of Michael in that hat walking along the gravel. That was a real turning point. Remember when Carlo is being garroted in the car, and it does, and then afterward he walks with the three guys? That's the image for me.
See, Michael was so wrapped in the fact that he was right, that what he was doing was right, that it blinded him, and it blinded his heart. In other words, was I so sure that I was right that I... that's why he says, did my heart betray me?
This time, don't say give one more chance. Just say give me the chance to redeem myself, if you can remember.
See, anything that could show Michael really turning on himself.
Can we go?
When a guy is really worried that he maybe is a bad man.
Finally, he's torn between good and evil. I mean, he is literally torn apart.
Maybe he's talking about one thing and then he...
I think when Francis... and Mario get together and start talking about this subject, anywhere near and around it, it's still in them, and there's something that stimulates them about it. And, Francis is a good example of that saying, man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for?
Mm-hmm.
guess a man that doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man.
You gotta get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit.
You're my older brother, but don't ever take sides with anyone against the family again. We're both part of the same hypocrisy. But never think it applies to my family.
Movies were very new to me, and Duval would say before each take, he said, no matter what you do, you're going to laugh on this take.
It's because I admire you, and I love you, that I kept things secret from you. Expect me to let you go? Do you expect me to let you take my children from me?
The Godfather was textured or perfumed in a way by our memories of our Italian-American family.
That you hadn't been let up for like 20 years. You've had this responsibility and the old.
The thing that's different about Godfather 3 and Godfather 2 is that Michael is different. But in order to see how he's different, we got to get a few tastes of it. Because we need a little emotion. If we could put a little emotion like in three places in the movie, that would be the thing.
Just have the weight of the gravity. That's what does it. You know what I'm saying is that you've never, from the time you committed that first sin, you've never had the weight off of you. Okay? Well, and you must have. You can't take it anymore.
Okay.
Just to be different.
It seems to me that whatever the film lay in a balance, that if I kicked it one side and kicked it to being more personal and more even soap opera or more emotional, that would be enough to kick it over, you know?
The audience has got to be like this. During this thing, you know, I mean, it's got to be Jesus. This guy is cracking. This guy is, for the first time, I know he's really.
See him anymore. He'll understand, believe me. Connie. If you don't listen to me, marry this man. You'd disappoint me.
And I think the version that was shown in San Diego was more heavily intercut. That the stories, each story interrupted the other more often. Rather than 12 back and forth, there were 20 back and forth or something. And the direction that we went after that screening was to just clear the decks a little bit, and or a lot, actually. And let the story tell itself up to a point and then go back to the other story and then let that story tell itself and go back. So that was an ongoing struggle, which I remember Francis saying at the end of that, if we'd only had two more weeks, it could have been great.
In Godfather 2, at the end of Godfather 2, as you remember, there's a scene where they flash back to the family in the happy days and Sonny was still alive and everyone's sitting around a dinner table.
Here's the cake.
And in this scene, Brando was going to be there too, you know, as a small cameo. And up until the very last minute, they expected Brando to appear for that day of shooting.
Oh, honey, that's nice, eh?
Should I put the candles on now?
Yeah, go on. You help, all right, Carlos?
Sure. Unfortunately, when the day finally arrived, Brando didn't show. There were legal problems, deal problems, etc. So Francis improvised and came up with the idea of making the event that everyone had gathered for Brando's surprise birthday party.
He's here. Come on.
Come on. Come on. Stoop.
One feels the presence of Brando without seeing him, which almost makes him more mythical and more of a memory than seeing the man's face would have done.
The second one was a continuation, and in a way, it was a kind of a descent, in a way, into trying to hold on to everything and losing it.
Cato, you're nothing to me now.
Look how they mess with my boy.
About 2-3 days later, I had to walk across the room, and Jimmy said, with his shoulders, you know, Francis, sir, could Bobby have a moment? So I go like this. Then I walk across the room and say, cut, Brando, give me a dirty look.
I remember a thing that happened on The Godfather that when we were working on it, I got the message that Bob Evans felt that there wasn't enough violence in the picture and that they were going to literally send a violence director in to kind of come in and do the violence.
It's funny.
I went that night with my sister Tally and my little boy Gio to the set, and we with Gio playing Carlo, who was like 8 years old, 9 years old, and Tally being there. I think I may have had a video camera, but I went in there and said, okay, violence.
You just told me to make you dinner.
Hey, Bafangul, huh?
Oh, Bafangul, you!
And we went down and we rehearsed it, and we thought how interesting it would be if she was pregnant and pitiful and hid behind the curtain and...
Knock down all the dishes. Then you go over there and knock down all the vases. Then Gio, go in there. Here's this little boy going in with the strap, hitting his hand. Now run to it. Now break the window. Now crash the thing, you know.
Now clean it up!
You look at that scene, you see the scene directed by a man who knew a violence director was coming.
Yeah. And Francis is very open, you know, to... there were a few scenes I remember. Once, at the beginning of the picture, I asked the prop master to cut an industrial broom handle off and put it in my car. He said, Jimmy, it's not in the script anyway. I said, so what? I mean, it's just put it there, you know. And sure enough, you know, when I got out of the car, it wasn't scripted, and Francis didn't expect it when I fired it at Gianni Russo.
Come here, come here.
But De Niro tried out for the part of Sonny. And he did. We shot a test on De Niro, which I think exists, that was so electrifying.
I think I did. Did I do the screen test for Sonny? Yeah. Me and 4,000 other people or whatever we all... Come in.
You're gonna take both of them out on me. You're gonna take them. And you know what they're gonna do to you? And you know what you do when you knock somebody off? You take a gun, you shoot him right up against his fucking head. That's what you do. You get his brains all over your nice new Ivy League suit, Michael. That's what happens. How do you like that?
It was spectacular, but it was Sonny really like killer, you know, like nothing you could ever sell.
A different idea of how to do it. One that most of us probably have not seen before, one that may or may not even practically be possible.
And I got this idea, you know, from Kurosawa. What if the guy just took, because this character wore big heavy glasses, just took his glasses and just ripped his aorta open with the glass because he knew he would be wearing the glasses.
He always has like a gush of blood, you know. Could kill him with a pencil. I don't want to kill him with a pencil.
Hey! Okay, Antonio?
Sure.
Okay.
Ready?
Action!
Wait, I gotta get him.
Creva! Bang!
Pulse it! Stop the blood!
Un momentino di più!
in the original cut of The Glasses Killing, which was first presented to the censors.
You got a Polaroid of that?
We were given an NC-17 rating for the Godfather film, unless we were willing to trim back the spurt, and therefore we did so for the final release of the film. The actual sort of real blood Catholic ritualistic aspect of the killing was sort of lost a little by having to censor it.
When I was a kid, my dad conducted a production of Cavalleria Rusta Caan. I used to go a lot with my father, and sometimes he would let me sit in the orchestra pit next to him. I remember four or five things just impressed me so much. One was the idea that these men had an argument and then one bit the other's ear and drew blood, and that that was a Sicilian way to do a duel, and it meant it would be a duel to the death.
Come on, Vincent. Come. Make your peace.
He basically told me a brief history of, you know, how this fits in the operatic sense. Here are these two men making their peace, and then the one guy crosses the line for a second by throwing in that one little, has to say that one little derogatory comment about his origin.
Bastardo.
And boom, next thing you know, the guy's clamping onto his ear.
The first take, I guess I missed the mark, and I was a little, you know, carried away. And when I ripped and